Simon & Schuster Audio presents Richer, Wiser, Happier. How the World's Greatest Investors Win in Markets and Life by William Green. Read by Raphael Corkhill.
Introduction. Inside the Minds of the Greatest Investors. I've been obsessed with investing for a quarter of a century. At first, it seemed an unlikely passion. I had never taken a class in business or economics. I had no talent for numbers and no grasp of the esoteric mysteries of accounting. After leaving Oxford with a degree in English literature, I reviewed novels for magazines and wrote profiles of fraudsters and murderers. As an aspiring author with high-minded dreams of literary fame, I found it easy to dismiss Wall Street as a casino full of crass speculators who cared only about money. When the New York Times landed on my doorstep, I would jettison the business section without even glancing at it. But in 1995, I found myself with a bit of cash to invest, my half of the proceeds from the sale of an apartment that I owned with my brother. I began to read incessantly about stocks and funds, eager to increase my modest windfall. This reawakened in me a gambling streak that had briefly run wild when I was a teenager in England in the 1980s. At 15, when I was a student at Eton, I'd sneak out of school on lazy summer afternoons and spend hours at a local turf accountant near Windsor Castle, betting on horses while my classmates played cricket or went rowing. I was meant to become a posh English gentleman like Boris Johnson, Prince William, and six centuries of Etonians before us. Instead, I had an illegal betting account under the name of Mike Smith. My interest in horse racing was fueled not by the romance of the sport or the majesty of the equine form, but by a desire to make money without working. I took it seriously, jotting down elaborate notes about horses and courses, using multicolored ink pens to highlight my wins and losses. I ruined my 16th birthday by fighting with my parents over their refusal to buy me a subscription to Time Form, a pricey system for rating horses. I was outraged that they blocked this obvious route to untold riches. Shortly afterward, following a string of disillusioning losses, I renounced racing once and for all. A decade later, when I began to read about investing, I discovered that the stock market offered similar thrills. But the odds of success were much higher. Stocks struck me as the perfect way to cash in merely by outthinking other people. Of course, I had no idea what I was doing. But I had one inestimable advantage. As a journalist, I could indulge my new fixation by interviewing many of the best investors in the business. In the years that followed, I interviewed a pantheon of investment legends for Forbes, Money, Fortune, and Time, returning again and again to the same overarching questions that fascinate me to this day. What principles, processes, insights, habits, and personality traits enable this tiny minority to beat the market in the long run and become spectacularly rich? More important, how can you and I profit by studying these financial outliers and reverse engineering their winning ways? Those questions lie at the heart of this book. To my delight, many of the investors I encountered were fascinating and oddly exotic. I flew to the Bahamas to spend a day with Sir John Templeton, the greatest global stock picker of the 20th century, who lived in a Caribbean idyll called Lyford Key. I traveled to Houston for an audience with Fayez Seraphim, an enigmatic Egyptian billionaire nicknamed the Sphinx. In his office, he displayed paintings by El Greco and Willem de Kooning, along with a 5th-century mosaic floor imported from a Syrian church. I spoke with Mark Mobius, the bald eagle, who flew around the developing world in a Gulfstream jet adorned with gold-plated fixtures and iguana skin upholstery, purchased from a Middle Eastern tycoon who had fallen on hard times. I interviewed Michael Price, a polo-playing centimillionaire who terrorized underperforming CEOs and came to be known as the scariest SOB on Wall Street. I met Helmut Friedlander, who had fled from Germany in the 1930s, stopping only to pick up his teenage sister and buy a hat, because a gentleman does not travel without a hat. He drank Chateau Petrus, collected precious medieval books, and traded everything from coffee futures to the Empire State Building. In his 90s, he told me, "I have lived uproariously." It was a priceless education. Jack Bogle, the index fund icon who founded Vanguard, which now manages $6.2 trillion, talked to me about the formative investment lessons he had learned from his mentor and hero, a mutual fund pioneer named Walter Morgan. "Don't get carried away. Don't take excessive risk. Keep your costs low." And "the crowd is always wrong." As we shall see, Bogle also explained why you don't need to be great to thrive as an investor. Peter Lynch, Fidelity's most famous fund manager, talked to me about how he had won by outworking everybody else. But he also spoke about the wild unpredictability of markets and the need for humility. "You get a lot of A's and B's in school. In the stock market, you get a lot of F's. And if you're right, 6 or 7 times out of 10, you're very good." Lynch recalled one of his first failures. A high-flying apparel business went bust, all because of the movie Bonnie and Clyde, which altered women's fashions so unexpectedly that the company's inventory became worthless. Ned Johnson, the multi-billionaire who built Fidelity into a behemoth, laughed and told Lynch, "You did everything right. Things come out of left field every now and then." In the tumultuous days after 9/11, when financial markets were suffering their worst week since the Great Depression, I headed to Baltimore to visit Bill Miller, who was in the midst of an unprecedented streak of beating the S&P 500 index for 15 years running. We spent a few days together and traveled in his Learjet, which he had bought in part so that his 110-pound Irish wolfhound could fly with him. The economy was reeling, war was brewing in Afghanistan, and his fund had tumbled 40% from its peak. But Miller was relaxed and cheerful, coolly staking hundreds of millions of dollars on beaten-down stocks that subsequently soared. One morning, I was standing beside him when he rang his office to check in. The analyst on the other end of the line broke it to him that AES, a stock that Miller had only just bought, had announced terrible earnings. The stock halved, costing him $50 million before lunchtime. Miller instantly doubled his bet, calmly assuming that irrational investors had overreacted to the company's dismal news. As he explained to me, investing is a constant process of calculating the odds. It's all probabilities. There is no certainty. And then there was Bill Ruane, one of the most successful stock pickers of his generation. When Warren Buffett closed his investment partnership in 1969, he recommended Ruane as a replacement for himself. Until his death in 2005, Ruane's Sequoia Fund generated stunning returns. He almost never granted interviews, but we spoke at length about the four guiding principles he had learned in the 1950s from a major star named Albert Hettinger. "Those simple rules have been of enormous importance to me," said Ruane. "They formed the basis for a large part of my philosophy ever since, and they are the best advice I can give people." "First," warned Ruane, "do not borrow money to buy stocks." He recalled an early experience when, by using leverage, he took $600 and multiplied it many times. Then, the market cracked, and he was hit so hard that he sold out and was back almost to square one. As he discovered then, you don't act rationally when you're investing borrowed money. Second, watch out for momentum. That's to say, proceed with extreme caution when you see markets going crazy, either because the herd is panicking or charging into stocks at irrational valuations. Third, ignore market predictions. I firmly believe that nobody knows what the market will do. The important thing is to find an attractive idea and invest in a company that's cheap. For Ruane, The fourth principle was the most important of all. Invest in a small number of stocks that you've researched so intensively that you have an informational advantage. I try to learn as much as I can about 7 or 8 good ideas, he said. If you really find something very cheap, why not put 15% of your money in it? For regular investors, there are safer paths to success.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.